David Dubal. On this, the fourth segment of Conversations with Claudio Arrau, we present an all-Liszt program. Liszt has always played an important role in Arrau's repertoire. Arrau's recordings of the Sonata, the Benediction to God in the Solitude, the B minor Ballade, Valet Dobermann, are among the finest Liszt interpretations on LP. His magnificence in the 12 transcendental etudes are treasures of the recorded art, and for pianists, documents of incalculable importance. Arrau plays Liszt in the grand manner, but with a seriousness of intent that leaves far behind the taint of mere glitter and shallow virtuosity, the Liszt that merely titillates. One may say that Liszt's spiritual nature is finally in evidence and totally exposed through Arrau's searching spirit. The tinsel is removed, but the color, poetry, and ardor remain. Let us again enter Claudio Arrau's world, and we hear of his early training with Liszt's disciple and student, the remarkable Martin Krause, 1853-1918.
Your tradition stems from a great one. You yourself are fond of saying that Czerny studied with Beethoven, and Czerny taught Liszt.
Liszt is.
And Liszt taught your great teacher, Martin Krause.
Yes.
This is an interesting example of a young man coming from Chile in
1911
to a gigantic capital at this famous Stern Conservatory. At first you didn't find the teacher that would be good for you. You're just a little man of 7 or 8,
yes,
trying to get along in the world. And all of a sudden, you come across a prophet, so to speak, a musical prophet. And you never had another teacher, even though you didn't have that many years with him.
Only 5 years. He not only developed the art of playing the piano, but the complete musician in every young pianist, and develop in every sense, culturally speaking. For instance, at the age of 8, I heard the first time Parsifal, which was an incredible child.
He had you then nourish your art on life itself and all the other arts.
Exactly, yes. Museums made me read the most important things in world literature. I saw all the great dancers of the time, and he wanted all around development, even in a very young musician. Never become a specialist of piano playing.
Become a specialist of art.
Of art.
I think I once heard that he actually taught you daily.
Exactly. He was very famous in those days and had a tremendous amount of pupils, but he made me practice in his house, in a special room, and came every few hours to watch whether I was practicing well. His daughters were all musicians. He had 6 or 7 daughters. And they also, they were supposed to watch me and tell him whether they thought something was wrong in my practicing or something. And he taught me 2 to 3 hours daily.
I'm flabbergasted.
And he never took a cent.
He truly had then that spirit, as I call it, of Weimar, that Listian.
Exactly, yes.
How many people, to put it bluntly, ever had a master like that for a teacher?
Well, I really grateful.
So you see,
to
he
him.
Gave you, Maestro Arrau, a mentor, a spiritual teacher of that level.
A guru.
A guru. A man who loved life and art. And he began then watching you and watching this orchid that was blossoming.
He even watched what I ate, my sleep, my general health. He walked with me almost every day for about half an hour.
How few people ever have anything like this?
Yes, I think I was very, very lucky.
Arrau never had another teacher. Krause died in 1918. And would have been proud of his student, for Arrau in 1919 and in 1920, at the age of 16 and 17, he won the very coveted Liszt Prize. We will hear Arrau presently in the fabulous and horribly taxing chordal etude, Wild Hunt, number 8 in C minor of the Transcendental Etudes. Note the immense variety of touches employed by Arrau, the breadth and the wild rapture, this of a man who recorded this set at the age of 75 with no diminishing of his enormous technical gifts.
Thank you.
That was the master pianist Claudio Arrau in the 8th Transcendental Etude of Liszt, one of the staggering technical contributions to the literature of the piano. Let's now return to more conversation with Arrau.
When you were growing up in this amazingly musical atmosphere of Berlin and with this tremendous figure, this great Liszt student, Martin Krause, did you feel you were special, or did he also inculcate into you a modesty? Because, of course...
Oh, yes. He was very keen on developing the real modesty in me, and he also made me hear all the great pianists.
Who were some of the great pianists that you were hearing as a child in 1912, 13, 14, 15?
Well, of course, Busoni.
Yeah.
D'Albert, Carreño, Ansorge.
Yes. Were you conscious with Krause that you were in a great tradition, the Liszt tradition?
Yes, very much so.
Did he himself, can I use the word, worship Liszt, as many
oh,
did?
Yes, absolutely.
What kind of man must this Franz Liszt have been? Awesome.
Yes, awesome. And very ambiguous. He had, of course, also a lot of vanity. But on the other hand, he was the most generous person in the world, I mean, and willing to help his pupils make careers and make connections for them. And also all those young composers around him, like Cornelius and Raff and Rezek. Oh, he must have been a marvelous person, but with probably certain weaknesses.
Yes.
But weaknesses without any importance. I use the word worship. I always worshipped the figure of Liszt and its music.
In 1877, Liszt was 66 years old and living at the Villa d'Este in Rome. The views from his apartments of the magnificent cypress trees and the famous fountains much affected him. He was often in a trance-like state of ecstasy. Here he composed Les Jetons à la Villa d'Este, a piece that both Ravel and Debussy cherished. We now hear this masterwork, Les Jetons à la Villa d'Este, in an overwhelmingly luminous performance by Claudio Arrau.
Thank you.
You have just listened to Claudio Arrau in Liszt's Les Jadeaux à la Villa d'Este. We now return to more conversation with Claudio Arrau.
When you came to Berlin as a child, was this an adventure for you, or did you know that you were in for a great deal of hard work? Did you feel already a sense of responsibility?
Yes. From a very early age, I felt a sense of responsibility in front of the works I was playing. And something went wrong, I blamed myself for what I called a lack of responsibility. Of course, in those days, it wasn't only that. It was, and something went wrong. It was because I was really a child.
The strain of being a prodigy is a relentless strain, and many people do not come through it.
So many child prodigies get sort of stuck at a certain moment, no, in the moment of transition from being a intuitive player into being a conscious player.
Yes.
That's a dangerous time, and many unfortunately get stuck.
You have taken your art so seriously, and this is where you are of that almost, I would call it, that philosophical school of piano playing that Busoni and Liszt, the spirit of Weimar, this wonderful quality of music as a spiritual nourishment.
I think that you said it in a wonderful way.
This is David Dubal, and this is the fourth program of our Conversations with Claudio Arrau. We now hear Arrau in Liszt's Waldesrauschen, Forest Murmurs. Arrau was just heard in Forest Murmurs, Waldesrauschen, a concert study of Franz Liszt. Let's now return to more talk with Claudio Arrau.
Busoni, yes. Busoni, who did the 9 Mozart concerti in 3 evenings, just shortly before he passed away.
Busoni was in Berlin when you were studying there.
Yes.
Did you have a chance to hear him often?
Oh, yes, very many times.
My own teacher, Arthur Lesser, said that he never got over the shock of hearing Busoni play the piano. Did you feel that?
Yes. That's very well said, because it had this incredible rhythmical vitality, and it just struck you from the very first note. Tremendously creative, whatever he did, his imagination was unheard of.
He, of course, was a great Listian. Did you know that Liszt would become a vital composer to you? Because in those days, people thought of Liszt as a cheap composer.
Yes. There was a big misunderstanding in many people about the importance of Liszt and the beauty and the high level of his music. I heard Busoni do the Liszt sonata in an unforgettable way. And he played also Alkan.
Even Alkan.
And he rediscovered him.
Yes. Did you learn this amazing amount of literature as a child, or did you just constantly keep studying?
I kept studying all the time, and I was never lazy. And I had this tremendous urge to get really acquainted with the music language of each composer, trying to develop my own way of molding the music of those composers.
Let's now return to the art of Claudio Arrau on this all-Liszt program. We hear the large-scale ballade in B minor, containing high dramatic effect with some of Liszt's most compelling melodic material. Arrau's performance is justly celebrated. Here is Maestro Arrau.
Thank you.
That was the Ballade in B Minor by Liszt. We return to this six-part series on the art of Claudio Arrau.
What strikes me again and again about Liszt's music is the mystical quality in all its forms, nature mystic and the mysticism of love. And, it reaches it, and, I mean, to great depth.
He could look at a painting or a piece of sculpture and it would inflame him to compose.
Exactly, yes. But he was such an incredibly cultured man and a wide horizon.
One of your most admired recordings is the Liszt Transcendental Etudes, these 12 epical wonders of technique and musical beauty combined. The Wild Hunt. This is an amazing piece of recklessness, isn't it?
Absolutely.
With that middle love theme, when they stop the hunt, it comes out of Weber, that kind
yes,
of romanticism.
Yes, it's very true. And the restlessness and then the drive and the whole thing, it's amazing. So, that and for me also Chasse-Neige.
And we'll hear Chasse-Neige tonight, the whirling snow, the winteriness of it.
Beautiful.
And all those notes, and yet it all has to be one great impression.
Exactly.
Chasse-Neige is still very unknown, you know, Mr. Arrau.
I know, yes, I don't play it at all. Very seldom in concerts.
Claudio Arrau has said, I don't think that today there is a Liszt school of playing, but I do very much think that there is a Liszt way of playing, the foremost ingredient of which is a kind of total freedom, the sonority stemming from the whole body, not just the fingers, with the ability to encompass great muscular endurance, large stretches, and the use of the whole arm from the shoulder. A free way of playing allows for the technical to be overcome so that one can reach out for the essence of the music. Krause always used to say that Liszt demanded more technique than one actually needed, so that the performance looked and sounded as if without effort. An important requirement, too, is emotional expansiveness of expression with a great dramatic sense and prolonged tension. Necessary, too, at times, is the ability to distort rhythm without impairing the musical idea and a demonic drive. But perhaps the most important quality necessary is creative imagination. Without this, all the rest is of little use. Liszt had the very sound of the piano in his bones. He knew its resources, knew every nuance that he wanted, and every lyric feeling that he desired to express. Those words by Claudio Arrau, and we now, for our final music, hear Arrau in Chasse-Neige of Liszt's. You have just heard Chasse-Neige by Franz Liszt in the hands of Claudio Arrau. This is David Dubal. Join us for our next program in this tribute to Arrau when we discuss Brahms.